Hi everyone. Should I reduce the volume? It's fine. So hi everyone, welcome back for the last set of the talks. So I am Kiran and I work as a freelancer and I also organize ReactJS Bangalore. I hope most of you here are front-end developers. So in my opinion, there are two main areas in front-end. One is UI. What I mean by UI is how the app looks or how the app behaves, right? Things like styling, you know, animations, those sort of things. And React does pretty good job with this thing, right? So React is primarily a UI framework and the API and simplicity of React works very well for us. So the second important challenge in front-end applications is state management. So what I meant by state management is like how we fetch data from the server, how we manage it on the front-end, you know, how do we do, how we implement business logic, how we keep our server in sync with the front end, those kind of things. So there are quite a few, unfortunately React does support some sort of state management, but it's not meant solely for that. Things like contest might help, but not for very large applications. So there are quite a few libraries like Redux, Mobius, and there are quite a few others as well. But still, even by using these libraries like Redux and Mobius, right, still we have to implement a lot of logic on our own, right? Even getting state management right with all these libraries is still hard. So this is where GraphQL helps, you know? So GraphQL has much more structured backend, right? Compared to REST, which is kind of, you know, not very strict. GraphQL has much more structured backend, right? Especially things like type system in the GraphQL and features like introspection GraphQL supports. These are my two favorite features of GraphQL. Features like type system and introspection help us build a lot of tools, right? And which will help us build better applications with less code, right? Apollo is one such tool which leverages the features of GraphQL. And Apollo is by far the most popular GraphQL client library. So GraphQL is something that runs on the server. And because of its unique features, right, we can build client-side libraries which leverage the functionality of GraphQL and make our life easy. So in this talk, I'll talk more about GraphQL, Apollo, and how it helps. Even with Apollo, it simplifies, it's much better than Redux or Mobius-based applications, but it still has its own challenges, and I will explain how to overcome those things. Yeah, so in GraphQL or in any backend-based applications, like we have three concepts. One is queries, mutations, and subscriptions. Queries are used to read data from the server, which is equal to get in HTTP, and mutations are to send to modify data on the server, which is equivalent to post with a HTTP, and subscriptions are for real-time updates. So if you are building any real-time applications, you might be familiar with sockets, right? So subscriptions is built on top of sockets, right, to provide real-time applications. So let's start with queries and see how Apollo helps with this. So this is a simple GraphQL query. Here you can see in this query, we are asking for users with and within users, we want properties like ID and first name, right? So this is a typical GraphQL query. So GraphQL is quite different from the REST in the sense, in GraphQL, clients ask for what they need. In REST, we just hit an endpoint and we get the data back. But in GraphQL, the clients request for what properties it need. For example, the user's database might have like 10 more properties, but the server doesn't return those properties. It just, the server returns just the users with ID and first name, because that's what GraphQL client asks for, right? So this is a simple GraphQL query. And to use it in our applications, we can wrap this with GQL. So GQL is a helper function which takes a string GraphQL query and converts into a JavaScript object, which we can use with Apollo or any other library. So how can we use this query and fetch data from the server and pass it to our components? So there are a couple of ways. And so using higher order component is one way. So we can import GraphQL from React Apollo. And user list is a simple React component which just renders, which gets a list of users and renders the users. And it's a user list is a simple React component. And we use a higher order component called GraphQL, and we'll wrap our user list component with GraphQL higher order component and pass user query. And so this is the only line of logic we have to write. And Apollo takes care of the rest of the things. Apollo makes an API call to the server, gets the data, and pass it to the server. Like if you are doing the same with Redux or anything, so you have to implement using some sort of as user or fetch, you have to make an API call, get the response, you know, implement you know, error handling, and you know, storing the data in the cache, so on and so forth. Right? So those things we need not do with Apollo. So because of the previous step, you know, in addition to fetching the data from the server and passing it to our components, we also get loading state and errors, right? And so for example, while the request is happening, the loading will be true. So if you want to show some spinner or something, we can do that. Or if the request fails, you know, we get errors, we can handle the errors as well. And if the request is successful, we'll get the user's data and we can use that to render the component, right? So you can see that, you know, without writing much code, right, we were able to get data from the server and, you know, use it in our, we are not writing any additional code for, you know, managing the loading state or handling errors or fetching the data. You know, Apollo is taking care of that automatically. All we have to do is write a GraphQL query and wrap our React components with GraphQL queries. That's all. And Apollo also caches the data in the sense, you know, once Apollo makes a request and it stores in the cache, and when we render the same component again, Apollo doesn't send the same request again, right? And so we need not implement that kind of logic also. Apollo takes care of itself. And Apollo stores the data very efficiently. For example, let's say when we made a request for the users, we got two user objects, right? And it is storing it with reference to user one and user two, right? And it stores that user one and user two objects separately, so that, you know, if some other queries fetches the same data, you know, we need not duplicate that data. So this is called data normalization, right? So it stores efficiently and avoid any data duplication. Also, if because of some other query, if one of these objects are modified, you know, the data will be synced across all the components. So there won't be any data inconsistencies. So if your application is read heavy, for example, if you are working on some media applications or some content-based applications where you read different sort of data and render it on applications, then GraphQL and Apollo works great. So as you can see, we haven't written much code, right? We are writing queries and, you know, wrapping our components with that. So if you are building dashboards or if you are building content-based applications, you know, this fits very well. So the next part is the mutations, where, you know, we are making edits and, you know, sending. So some of the applications where mutations will be heavily used is some sort of CRM-based applications where, you know, user enters data and that data is saved into the backend applications. So let's see how, you know, Apollo fares with this. So to send data, to make changes to the server, right, again, we write queries. These are called mutation queries. In this case, we are writing update user, and to this update user field, we are passing arguments, right? So GraphQL query language is quite extensive in the sense, you know, it has arguments, it has variables, you know, it's quite extensive. So in this case, we are using variables like arguments like ID and first name. And in response, we are we want to mutate the server with ID 1 and first name is called Johnny. And once this mutation is, once the server got updated, we want to get the response back. In the response, we want ID and first name. Ideally, the data will be the same. So this is a typical mutation query. As you can see, in this query, we hard-coded, you know, ID and first name. But in real applications, we don't want to do that, right? So we want to use some sort of parameterization. So for that, we can use things like GraphQL variables. In the sense, you know, we have one more layer where, you know, after mutation, we can give an operation name. And in the operation name, right, we can specify the augment types. In the sense, for example, we can say ID is of type int and first name is of type string, right? So GraphQL is a strongly typed language. So whether it is getting data from the server or, you know, specifying the augments, you know, it takes care of, you know, it takes types very seriously, right? So this query is almost same as the before, except that in this case, instead of hard coding the ID and first name, we are using parameters. So the how can we call that query? There are several ways to do that. So this is one of my favorite way where we will directly call mutate on the client, right? So how we get this Apollo client? It's during the setup phase, we will use Apollo client library and, you know, give the cache and so on and so forth arguments. And finally, we'll get a client library, Apollo client. And that we can directly call mutate. And for that, we can pass the mutation, which is the query which we wrote earlier, and pass the variables. So these variables will be passed to the query and it will be evaluated on the server. And once this mutation is executed, we get the response from the server in some sort of this fashion, like we get the data inside that we have update user, because the mutation field which we sent is update user. So in the response object also we get the update user, and inside that we have ID first name, right? Because that's what we asked for. And in addition to that, we have underscore underscore type name. As you can see in my previous cache diagram, right? So Apollo is storing with as references like user one, right? So these cache keys are very important, because whenever Apollo sees some response from the server, and if it finds underscore underscore type name and ID, right, it immediately maps with the cache and updates it. So we need not write any code. In the sense, you know, we got some response from the GraphQL server. Apollo automatically understands that, okay, this data should be updated at that particular location and updates it, right? We need not write any logic. So again, this is very helpful. And it also supports something called optimistic response. Let's say, for example, if you are implementing chart application and you entered something, right? You want to see that message immediately, even before that message went to server and come back, right? It takes some few milliseconds. Before even getting response from the server, we want to show that response immediately. For that, we can use this optimistic response. In most of the cases, we know how the response, for example, when we are sending a message, we know what the message will be, right? Even before coming from the server. So we can give a mock response based on our assumption. In this case, you know, for example, update user, we are sending ID and first name, but that's the same response we are going to get back. So we can give a mock response as an optimistic response. So what Apollo does with this thing is, it renders the React components twice. Once before getting the response from the server, and once after getting the response from the server. So that's where you see the instant response. In the sense, you know, you type some, you enter something, you immediately see the response even before getting the response from the server. And once the actual response comes from the server, you know, Apollo re-renders again and, you know, does it correctly. So this gives you, you know, perceived better performance. As you can see, it looks good in the sense, you know, we are not writing any additional logic to update cache or anything, but still it seems quite verbose, right? All we want to do is update first name, but for that we have to write a query and, you know, we have to call that mutation function. So it seems verbose, right? What if we have a function like update record, right? And for that we'll say, I want to update record for the type name user and ID 1. And this is the data I want to save it to the database. And this update record method can be used for n number of fields. For example, your application might be having like 30 tables, and you can use this method to update any table and any property, right? So we can do that. You know, Apollo doesn't provide this method, but we can implement our own, on our own, right? We can write a generic function, right? We can use this three information like type name, ID, and data, and generate the query which I have mentioned before, right? Which essentially contains this information, right? We can take this information, write a function which generates that query automatically, right? And call the mutate function. So with the help of that function, we can have a cleaner API like this. Instead of writing the mutation query for every single update, we'll write a generic function and use that function everywhere, right? So this reduces the boilerplate code. So far, we are looking at the good parts of the Apollo, right? So we have seen how fetching the data from the server with Apollo is very easy, and you know how it provides loading status, errors, you know how it's providing cache, right? And how we can handle updates. We have discussed that you know updating is slightly verbose, but it's handling the cache well, but it's slightly verbose. But we were easily able to write a simple function called update record and remove that verbosity. So far we are good with Apollo. So these are the hard parts of Apollo, you know, creating and deleting objects and you know subscriptions. So these two things require a lot more effort than the previous cases. I'll explain why this requires more effort. Let's say you want to delete a user, right? And again, you write a mutation query called delete user and you pass an argument called ID. So you want to delete user number one, right? And in return, you just get an ID, right? But Apollo don't know what to do with that. You know, we send a mutation to delete user and you got the ID back. What should Apollo do with that? But in previous case, you know, update, it can update the cache. But in the delete case, that particular object might be referred from several other places, right? So Apollo can't guess where it has to delete. So it's our responsibility to give it more guidance. So this way things get complex. In the sense, you know, in addition to the passing the mutation and variables, right, we have to implement a method called update, right? And in this update, have three steps. Like first, again, Apollo cache stores the data in a separate format. We can't directly read the data, right? The only way to read the cache is reading the query. So to read the cache, we'll pass a query, right? And we'll use cache.readQuery and pass a query and we get the user's data. And we want to delete a user, right? So we will filter, we'll iterate over the users and delete the user which we don't want. Now we get new set of users and we'll write it back, right? So we have three steps. And this is a simple case, right? Things can get complex. Let's say you have a role-based application where you know you have users who have roles like admin, super user, and user, right? And we have different queries to get this data. The moment you delete a user, you have to update these queries as well. So the previous query, the previous logic which I have shown is for one query. Let's say you have to implement the same logic for three more queries, right? So you can see it's already 20 lines of code. And it can be a hard, tedious, and it can be error prone as well. For example, let's say someone else is adding a new feature, right? And they added a new query. They might forget to add update method in the old features, right? And it causes a lot of problems and inconsistencies. So manually implementing the other way of doing, instead of implementing the update method, is refetching all the queries, right? Again, manually specifying which queries to refetch is also tedious and it has the same problems as this, right? So can we automate it, right? Instead of manually implementing the update method, which we have seen is quite verbose, can we automate it? So again, previously I have shown an update record method where we are passing type name, ID, and data. And that API looks good, right? And can we have the similar API for this? When I want to delete some particular object, all I want to call is like call some function like delete record, pass the type name and ID. That's all I want to do, right? So the rest of the logic should be taken care by the delete record method. But Apollo doesn't provide it. Can we implement on our own? So if we can find out all the queries which are related to user, so I'll show you a demo. So you can see here, right? Currently there are two users, right? And when I add a new user, right? And I assign a role as admin. You can see the moment I add a role as admin here, this list got updated. And if I go ahead here and change the role to user, you can see this particular section of the UI got updated, right? And if I delete something, right, you can see that, you know, the user from this section got deleted. So the UI is interlinked. And to implement this, we have like four queries. One query is to fetch the users from the server, and we have three queries here. One query is to get the list of admin users, one query is to get the list of super users, and one query is to get the list of users, right? So how can we do that? As we discussed, so till now, like doing that manually specifying the update method or manually specifying which queries to refetch is tedious and error prone. So how can we do that automatically? So Vivek today morning discussed about AHT, right? So we can use some tools like AHT traversal and GraphQL schema introspection, right? These are the some of the features of the GraphQL, and we can use these to automatically identify which queries need to be automatically updated. So this is a simple GraphQL query, right? So the entire query is called a document, right? And inside, if you see, whenever you see a curly braces, it's called a selection set, right? Anything within the curly braces is called list of selections, and the first one is called the field. Again, it goes on. So it has a predictable structure, right? And this is very basic query. The AHT of that particular simple query looks something like this. It looks daunting, but it has very predictable structure. So that's what AHTs are for, right? It takes the AHTs, takes the human readable code and converts into a much more complex structure. But these complex structures are friendly for programming, right? So today morning we have seen how Vivek has described how we can use AHTs to write Babel plugins and ESLint plugins. The same concept applies here. As you can see, for the previous queries, we have selection set. Inside that, we have selections. Inside that, we have field called users, right? So the next part is like schema introspection, right? So this is the query which can be used to get the data related to the schema, right? And so in this case, you know, we can get the list of the fields and the types of those fields, right? We can combine these two things to automatically find the queries which are related to users. And in addition to that, Apollo tracks all the queries in the app. For example, as you are using the app, Apollo keeps fetching the data from the server, and it also tracks those queries which it has already executed. So Apollo has a list of the watched queries, and let's say you want to delete an user. So you, from the list of all the queries, we have to filter out the queries related to the user, right? So we can use the AHT concept, iterate over the queries, find the queries which has field users, right? If we have any confusion related to the type of the fields, we can use the result from the introspection. Once we have the list of queries related to the user, we can implement a generic update method, right? We can iterate over those queries and implement the three-step process which we have done. Read the cache, do the whatever modifications we have to do, and write it back, right? We can automate it. The challenging part is finding the queries related to user. For that, we can use the AHT and introspection. So the same problem happens for create also, right? When we're creating, right, it will have some side effects. Right, those things also should be updated. For that also, we can implement the same logic similar to delete record. So the next part is subscriptions. Subscriptions is a little bit hard to implement. Subscriptions are used for real-time updates. It has like a lot of moving parts, like, you know, whenever you change something on the server with mutations, if you want to implement subscriptions, we have to publish those changes. Like, let's say you added a new user, you publish that, right? And you have to implement a subscription resolver. In that resolver, you implement authorization, so on and so forth, right? On the front end, you'll write a subscription query, right? And again, the subscription has the same challenges which I described for the delete and update, right? The subscription will get the real-time updates from the server, but once it gets the real-time updates from the server, Apollo don't know what to do it. If a new user got added, what should Apollo do? It doesn't know, right? So here also the challenge of, you know, implementing the update method happens, but, you know, we can use some of the methods which we have developed, but still it's verbose, right? And it requires a lot of effort to implement these subscriptions, and, you know, it also causes performance. For example, in our application, we have 30 tables, and for each table, we have 3 subscriptions, one for delete, one for update, and one for creating a new item. Like, if we have 90 subscriptions, the performance of the app will grow high. The more the number of subscriptions we have, the bad the performance of the app will be, right? So there's an alternative proposal called live queries, right? So the idea with the live queries is we have a regular GraphQL query and we'll mark that as an @ live, right? So without implementing any logic, the library which we are using should take care of keeping this data in sync with the server. If something changes on the server, client should automatically get updated, right? Without writing any code. That's the ideology. So this is still in the proposal phase, which is not yet confirmed, or there are no implementations available. But in our applications, we had to implement it on our own because, you know, we have a big application and subscriptions are not working out for us. So we went ahead and, you know, started implementing on our own live query system. So the implementation will look something like this. You know, whenever the clients are querying the data from the server, we wrote an extension which keeps track of all the objects which are sent to the clients, right? We'll store that in the Redis. When the clients are sending the mutations, right, we'll use database trigger to identify those changes that are happening, right? So we'll use these two information, like the data, the objects which are stored in the Redis and the triggers, and based on this, we will write a efficient subscription, single subscription, to keep the data in sync. So the beauty of this architecture is we have decoupled our, you know, data syncing logic from our business logic, right? So it's kind of a one-time effort. We'll implement just a single subscription. Instead of having like hundreds of subscriptions, we'll have a single, very generic subscription called onChange, which will get the data action. This action could be either an update, delete, or create, right? So it can be one of these three actions, and data is the actual data which is changing, and type name and ID. So with this just single subscription, we can keep our entire front end in sync with the back end. Again, yeah. So Apollo is mostly good. Things like mutations and subscriptions are a little bit hard, but we welcome them with you know, implementing our own systems like you know, update record and live queries. Yeah. So that's all I have. So if you have any questions, you can reach out to me at Kirana_Abori. Do you have any time for questions? Okay.